Okay, welcome back. Sorry about that slight delay. We will have the next... The next one is going to be... Not sure the next is going to be, because not everything has been completely sorted out yet. Old Ghost Docker still hasn't showed up. That's not unusual. Aquanim and Kane is actually being played right now, so that would be the one to go for, I guess.
Yep, that's their first match.
And how many minutes has it been? It has been 2 minutes. We still have time. Run! Quick! Get the match. Okay. So we have Aquanim and Kane on Cooper Hill, because that's where everyone starts out. Kane... Oops. On Cooper Hill... And the game is already going. It started a little while ago. 2 minutes ago. So we're not too far behind. But this map, well, you might as well be. Alright, so let's piece together what's going on here. Aquanim, actually neither player reclaiming very much. What the heck? Kane is reclaiming a little bit now, but neither player is focusing on the reclaim. Kane taking the hill early on, but not really got a whole lot to support it. While Aquanim, on the other hand... Not bothering to go over the hill at this point, which is wise. You want to go around when your opponent has it.
Yeah, they're both starting out a little bit heavy on the constructors, though. Kane is reclaiming now. Aquanim is not reclaiming. He has three constructors, which is
that
quite a lot.
Makes no sense. Reclaim.
I expect them to be reclaiming now. He has one on reclaim, but it's mostly doing energy, which you need a mix of both, but it might get sniped out.
True. And yeah, that, well, might is not exactly the word I'd use. Just did.
Well, they're shield bots, so you never know. They have a lot of hit points, but yeah, he wasn't able to respond in time with the bandits.
Yeah, so at this point, Kane taking a fairly firm hold of the center of the map, but as you mentioned, neither player really reclaiming as much as their constructor counts would imply, particularly Aquanim. And it's just, yeah, I can see you taking energy, but why take it off the hill? That's a bit too risky at this stage. You can to deny it somewhat, but I would take it from your own base first. Just take the safe one.
Glaive on the back, doing a bit of damage, takes out one metal extractor, which is not that big a deal. That's not bad.
Plus 2 points.
He's marching in the middle with his battle commander, probably going to do some defense wars here. This will be interesting.
Yeah, Kane
has... I don't think he has the economy. Oh, he's trying to tank with the shields. That's the very neat trick, that one. You see that all, the shields taking all the damage, so it lets you get the LT up in time. This is a real advantage shields bot having in this kind of engagement, but the shields are falling now.
Yeah, they're falling, and the LLTs are not up yet. One of them is up, but it's not able to hit.
He's out of energy to repair.
Aquanim, however, is going to...
And he can't see the targets he's shooting at, so his LLTs are actually missing.
Can't see them yet, but also...
He has line of sight on them now.
Aquanim's commander just upgraded. Ouch. Yeah, there's...
Here come the glaives.
Here come the glaives,
the commander should be okay. It's getting morphed.
Okay.
Someone guessed rocket launcher. Yep, it's a rocket launcher commander.
Rocket launcher versus
first LLC goes down. I think he might.
Second LLC's down. The center of the map is open. Well, sort of. There are still defenders up there. Kane.
Yep. Kane's backing up and making a line of defenders. Yeah.
But they're kind of over the hill from each other, so it's not easy for the defenders to hit each other. They're in a position where neither player can really get on the top of the hill, but neither player really has control of the hill either. The hill is a complete no man's land at this point. Which is probably fine. That'll encourage the players to go around and use the rest of the map, as Kane is currently doing.
Mm-hmm.
Nice go around.
On the side, but he pulls back wisely. There's too many bandits there to really get much done, and there's an LLT.
Although
but he's had a scout in, and he's also pulled Aquanim's forces back to defend.
No flank, though. Nothing coming in from the center of the map in order to take advantage of this. Or not the center as much, but the north side of the map to take advantage of this. So,
it's fine though, even just having the glaives there, he's creating presence. While he's expanding in both directions, up and down, this spooks Aquanim, and Aquanim's going just reclaim and pull his forces back, rather than contesting the middle as much, as strongly as he could have, because he could take out all his defenders right now. So, Kane's conceded the center, and he's pulling back to expand. So hopefully he's hoping, I think, that he's, this economic boost will allow him to do a push after that.
Yeah, he knows, though.
It's a rocket commander, and he knows that he knows he can't beat it.
Yeah. Bit of a gamble, though, just because the... Well, I mean, Aquanim has called Kane's bluff. They have gone to the center of the map. Although, at this point, Aquanim's commander is so weak, the glaives could actually kill it if it gets too far ahead of itself. It has to be extremely careful.
Yeah, he knows this, and he's pulling it back to repair.
Yeah, there we go. Okay, that's good. Aquanim would not let that die, I'm sure. Not that easily, at least.
You can see Kane just sweeping out the north, just doing these scouting raids where he goes in, sees if there's any constructors, sees if there's any metal extractors, sees that there's not any, so he just sends in these two scouts just to try and snipe something out, just to get a little more intel. But he knows he's not expanding there, and he knows he can just pull his glaives back, and he doesn't need to worry, because he knows he's out expanding his opponent. He doesn't need to send the glaives in and then suicide them on the base. He just needs to know that he's sniping any constructors that are moving out there, and that the enemy's not expanding into that space.
Yeah, and as a result, Kane basically putting all the pressure on, allowing him to take the entire east side of the map, getting nearly double the economy, getting an air switch now as well. A pure air switch, too. They've dropped the Clokey. They've completely dropped Clokey. They're not even bothering with that. And Iconum's commander, not particularly well repaired, so at this point, it's still extremely vulnerable. I mean, there are convicts nearby, and the hill is pretty solidly in Aquanum's control, but I think that Kane could just run back once again. Run around the back.
Two ravens, and that commander is dead, but he knows, he sees it on radar. He sees the movement, and he knows that's a bomber. So he's making himself a hacksaw, and he also has a Faraday, which might be able to stun out the bombers when they come in to dive. Yep, it's up, he's safe.
Yeah, that hacksaw is good.
4 seconds. Yeah, it's good. He's fine.
But it doesn't really matter, though, with all the glaives going around the back, forcing Aquanum back, and Aquanum does not have the bandits in position. Getting rid of... Oh, nice. Yep. Nice convict snipe. That's what Kane's been doing so far. They've been going around sniping convicts. Okay, they're getting way too risky here. Losing a lot of glaives. This is not going to work out. They lost way too many glaives.
That's the sort of thing I was talking about that you shouldn't do. When you come in and you sweep and you see that he's not expanding in an area, don't suicide against the base because you lose units.
Yeah,
because now, at this point, Aquanum's expanding. He's taking reclaim. If he's going to win, it's on reclaim at this point. But Kane has started to reclaim as well, but not as heavily.
No, that's
fine. So Aquanum's staying in this on reclaim.
That's 350 metal right there that's got donated, effectively.
Mm.
And that, for Aquanum, for the amount of reclaiming they've been doing so far, that's basically a whole minute, which on this map is an eternity, worth of an extra +5 metal.
Here come the bombers, but nothing. No,
the shields are too much in the way. Actually, no, they're
almost
not.
Get
what?
The commander, but oh, I guess it's too much.
Oh, it's too tall. But yeah, it doesn't matter. It'll get repaired, and then what? Scythes? No, not bad, but there's too much of the forest.
There's enough scythes there. They could do a bit of damage. It depends on how many micros them.
Well, it looks like Kane...
It looks like he's... Well, yeah,
the north side's fine. The north side's good. The eastern side is going to basically kill itself to scout out defense.
He's in trouble. Yeah, the commander might go down.
No, the commander's
going down.
Commander goes down. Commander does successfully get killed.
That was too many scythes to lose, though. That was not worth it.
Yeah, that was what? 4,000 metal worth of scythes? Or not
4,000, I think.
No, never mind. Sorry. 1,000. 1,000.
Yeah, 1,250.
I got their cost and their health mixed up. Sorry. But yeah, still, that's 1,250 metal worth of scythes. To get rid of a commander in Aquanum's territory.
You could have done it with one, two max to be safe. And yeah, he lost too many.
Yeah, that's, again,
it's getting reclaimed now as well, so.
More and more donation. That's another 800 metal donated. At this point, Aquanum's going to be able to ride out the entire game with an extra 10 metal per second just because of that donation, those two donations.
Aquanum's excessing now. That's how, you know, how big his economy is.
Yeah, then that's not terribly surprising, but yes, that would be good for them to get some, wind gens. I'm a bit surprised how few people build wind gens around the back. I was actually noticing I casted a game on this on Wednesday, and I saw one of the players sending units around the back, around those hills in the, very far center, east and west, trying to look for wind gens, and nothing was there, because no one builds them anymore, but people still expect them.
This is a real problem. He's trying to use hammers to fight up the hill, but I'm not sure he's used to this, but hammers cannot fire up hills. They're one of the lightest artillery in the game and an excellent way to clean out defend nests and stuff, but it's not in a hilly position. Hammers lose tons of range shooting up hills, and they can't actually outrange the defenders at all.
Yeah, that's, physics.
Yeah, hopefully these rockers around the side, this rocker-warrior group mix, is going to clear out these metal extractors and swing Aquanum the next game back in Kane's favor and away from Aquanum. Yeah, it took out this geothermal plant, which he was trying to make.
That will not be a problem, because... How many... Okay, there are 8 bandits right now, and most of what Aquan has been spending their money on has been static defenses at the center of the map. So Kane actually has a really powerful army right now, not just to counter what Aquanum has, but in general. Even if Aquanum is going for good counters, Kane still has a powerful army, and given that Aquanum is not countering this, it's even worse.
And Kane, again, does the right thing. He sees... He pushes in... He puts himself between the expansion and the base, pulls back, takes out the expansion, and even though the enemy's quite weak now and he probably could have gone in,
didn't risk it.
He's taking taking out the expansion for free and containing the enemy. This is just perfect what you should do. This is how to not lose your units. This is perfect.
Which, good to know Kane learned their lesson after the glaive donation. But still, that's...
That was in his micro. You could see he said he knows what he's doing, but he got a little bit too close,
Yeah, I got a bit greedy. But yeah, Kane, the only thing though, they don't have the reclaim Aquanim has. Like, Aquanim still has the center of the map, even killing three metal or plus three metal worth of extractors.
Kane's not paying attention again. He's losing all these units. He should have his warriors forward engaging the bandits. He's losing, the rogues are taking out his warriors. Yeah, that was not good. He should have pulled them back in a more orderly fashion. He's put them on fight order and move order. He must have been paying attention elsewhere.
I think it was about four or five of them that died for nothing for that. That was a bit of a pain. And Aquanim, they still have the center. They still have a lot of reclaim. Like, right from the center, they still have 1250 reclaim in caretaker range, or 1370 reclaim. That's over 2 minutes of an extra plus, like 2 minutes of at least economic parity without metal extractors. Not including metal extractors or overdrive. Getting to economic parity. This is still pretty risky.
Aquanim's managed to pull that out. He switched into rogues, and this was the right response to a mixed warrior and Rocco Force. Rogues are really good against Cloakbot in general in a lot of ways.
Yeah,
he's got all these exposed title, these wind generators on the top though, which it looks like these scythes might spot.
They might, but they shouldn't go for this. This thing is, it's tempting. They just can't go for it. Kane needs to not deal with that. They have, I think, seen it though. I'm not totally sure. Yeah, they've seen it. Kane is totally aware that it exists. If you check their vision,
we have scythes being used against these. Oh, they all got stunned. That's interesting.
Wow, those Faradays, I don't see those a whole lot just in exhibition matches and regular play, but ladder matches, I guess. But they've been really showing up these last couple games.
It's really hard to assault up this hill. He can't do it. He really can't afford to do this. This is with the rogues there. The rogues are in this perfect position. They're in this nest. This is why, even though Aquanim has been behind on economy the whole time and the scythes in the back are again taking out the expansion, so he's getting contained again. Having that hill allows you to project so much power straight on top of the enemy's factory that Kane's having a lot of difficulties with this, even with scythes, which are typically really good at assaulting into something where, you know, obviously they can go up the hill and start attacking like this,
but not in this
there's
case.
Just too much defense there.
It's just, if they got rid of the hacksaw, I think if they had where to target anything, you should get rid of the hacksaw. But there aren't a lot of air units at the moment. But if they got rid of that, at least they'd have a bit more flexibility. The defenders would still be a problem, though, but at least they have a bit more flexibility to throw out a napalm bomber or something.
This is the way he's using them now. He's taking out a ton of rogues that are threatening his commander. Mm-hmm. Yeah, he's using these, but they can assault to some degree, but if you put them into a lot of defenses, they'll get taken out pretty fast.
Yeah, and there's no choice but doing that when it comes to the top of the hill. And now a Stinger being set up, and I think this is set up in... No, not quite in range. Stinger is not quite in range of Kane's base. It's still going to be a pain in the butt.
Yeah, Kane's going back to bombers, maybe to bomb out the rogues, I'm not sure.
I agree with that, except, like I said, get rid of the Razor's Kiss, or not the Razor's Kiss, the Hacksaw first. Very risky, almost got into the Hacksaw range. Managed to get rid of damage one of the rogues, not even get rid of it. This isn't dealing a huge amount of damage yet. And Aquanim is pulling it back just from that reclaim. At this point, how much do they have? Yeah, they still have they still have 1,000 metal easy of reclaim.
We're talking about stingers and when to build stingers and where to build stingers. And yeah, in a position like this, in the center of the map, it's so important to, you know, if you have this really strong thing. And, you know, even without the hacksaw there, there's just enough defenders that, you know, you really can't use phoenixes into a defense line. You have to use them to bomb a big fat army of skirmishers or something which doesn't have appropriate support. You can't use them into a defense line like that, like he did.
And Kane losing a lot of scythes again.
Scythes are very expensive. They're much more expensive than most people think.
Yeah, that's 400 metal that just got in there. Like, there's just so much metal that Aquanim has. We are not going to see Aquanim need metal extractors for the rest of the game. They could not build static metal for the rest of the game and they'll win. Kane's been pushed back that far against the wall.
Yeah, even though Kane's held so much economy and he's had almost no raids, it just shows the strength of Aquanim's position. Oh. The fight's happening on his territory, he's getting the reclaim, he's just threatening Kane, so Kane's constantly responding rather than having, you know, the initiative. He did such excellent raiding, and you know, anyone can learn from sort of the raids he did around the side, other than the few micro arrows where he was losing units, but just the general strategy he adopted.
But JumpBot now here, probably for Firewalker or Sumo, I'm not sure which.
Yeah, he's got to get out of the hill somehow, and he knows it. He's also got to counter these rogues. Yeah, firewalkers. That'll do both. But let's see if he can get it up.
Well, they have a minute, which I don't think they have a ton of time. At this point, Aquanim is essentially in their base. Yeah, they're in their base. They're destroying everything. And Drone in the chat pointing out the snipers would have been a good idea. Maybe? I mean, they would have been able to get rid of the defenses fairly easily, but yeah, I...
Yeah, he tried hammers at one point. You really, with that sort of a defense nest, if it's in a position that's threatening you, there's two ways to deal with it. Either you need to take it out, or you need to go around. With it threatening you like that, it's really difficult to ignore it and go around. So he tried making hammers, but the hammers just couldn't shut the hills, so snipers would have been a much better approach there.
Yeah.
When the hammers didn't work, he decided, I'll go around, made scythes, hit around the side, but he lost too many of them, and there was too much threat to his own base, and now he's losing so much, yeah.
Yeah, the only way they could
have... This shows the strength of positioning.
Yeah, the only way they might have been able to get around it would have been to kill the factory and kill the nearby workers to at least... They get rid of the build power that way for a minute or so, like 30 seconds to a minute, to at least give themselves a bit more breathing room. Not great, but at least it's something.
Yeah, we have the Firewalker up now, and it could hit all these units, but it seems to be hitting the ground.
Yeah, it's kind of firing at a random point, which isn't doing too much good.
It's probably leading these bandits.
Okay, I guess that's one way to surrender the game. So at this point, Kane is dead. This is game. We're going into game two.
That was a fascinating game. That was so fascinating. Aquanim was on the ropes the entire time, sort of not having enough expansion and what have you, but it's that battle command we had in the middle and securing that center, which was very much conceded by Kane. Kane probably could have responded it another way to respond to defense is to set up your own defense, which is outside of range of that. So if he set up his own, because Shieldbot does not have very strong artillery, it just has disabling artillery.
Yeah.
If he set up his own HLT or line defenders, that would be more difficult to push into. And then he could have continued to raid around the side or what have you. But yeah, you do need to contest that center hill. It's very important on Cooper Hill.
So anyway, we're going to be moving on to game two. Not sure what's happening. And let's just go over the brackets a bit. So it looks like Steel Blue beat Parzival and got a bye because Old Ghost Stalker did not show up. Snogabay is also getting a bye to Losers, I guess, Losers Semis 1. And Felthos also getting a bye against Stuart 98. Apparently, who also didn't show up. We saw them beat Agent 3 E382, and Drone and Exploit will be playing now. And the winner of this match plays against Google Frog, and I want to see that because that should be interesting. Probably Aquanim versus Google Frog at this point, given it is 1-0. But Kane gets the map choice. So Kane, having learned a little bit about how some of the mechanics of the game work as a result of this particular match. Let's see. We will have this move on to... Oh, what map is it? I really want to know. Kane has not yet decided. But when they do... I don't know, I think Kane... They're going kind of micro-y. Clearly something small is up their alley. I'm not sure it would really work, though. Icy Shell might work okay. Assuming Aquanim doesn't take the center. But that's another problem. Desert Cliffs, I think, might require a bit too much getting around choke points. Though Kane might work well in there. Iced Coffee, I guess, if you want to be sneaky, as Kane has been, and not worry about the center too much.
Yeah, I think probably try to play to his strengths here, but I'm not sure what his strengths are of Aquanim. Kane's a very good player in general, but... Aquanim is too. I'm not sure what he specializes in. I think maybe vehicle flat maps. He might go for something like Titan Duel.
Yeah, we'll see if... Well, I could see that, but I don't know. I still think that there'd be a lot of room in Titan Duel or something like it just to deal with this. Like, if you think about what Titan Duel has, it's big, it supports fast expansion, it gets a lot of macro play is rewarded on that map, so I could sort of see it, but I don't know. That seems like something that would just fall apart. Okay, Baron or Avalanche? Interesting.
I think Kane's expansion and raiding was really good there.
That's true. So. Kane had the better economy most of the game, at least as far as static mexes went. But they're going for Avalanche. Or Baron. But either way, they're going for a smaller map. So I had it. Didn't call Avalanche, though, but same style of map. So yeah, we're going to probably see Avalanche, which I'm interested in, or... Okay, Acronym decides that they're going to go for Baron. I'm not sure why... We didn't have a rule that you picked two maps and the winner chose between them, did we? I don't recall that. Oh yeah, it is. Yeah, losing player suggests two different maps and then the winner will choose it. Interesting. Okay, so we're going on to Baron. Which I can actually now go over because the players are giving me a bit of time. I've already gotten in the match, finally! So we are moving on Baron, which is... Well, as the maps, as the name suggests, not particularly populated with items. Or, well, anything, really. It's kind of gray. Kind of empty.
Yeah. On this, which impromptu defend two, sort of, two clusters of two. And the other ones are very well spread out, so it's a lot of it's about holding choke points up cliffs, but bots can come up cliffs at any point, so it's mostly sort of, you know, contesting the ravine. But then the corners are very important into the mid game, and so who takes them and who manages to stop their opponent from taking them for the longest time, because there's three maxes there, is very important.
Yeah, this map tends to get really as a result, and we do see that Kane goes for Shieldbot, Acronym goes for Cloakybot. So, a flip of the factory choice from last game. Interesting. I kind of agree with this, but on the other hand, this is probably going to get pretty bogged down, because having a shield player on this map typically does that.
Yeah, this is an 8x8, so it's a small map, but it is diagonal positions, so that sort of gives it more size. So, it feels definitely larger than that last map, which is one of the smallest in the pool, and also has the hill in the center, which means that once you get to the hill, it's downhill towards the enemy, rather than a lot of maps such as this one, where it's uphill towards the enemy if you take the center.
Yeah, so this one, it's going to be... Usually what ends up happening is you get the center being just a graveyard. There's defenders up on the sides, up in the defended areas, and that's about it. And then, of course, as a result, the center ravine is just death. No one can go there, everyone dies. But at this point, we're still in the more dynamic stage of the game, where enough can happen around the map that it's not going to be too boring. It's not going to be boring to watch, it's still going to be fairly interesting. If Kane goes around from the north side... Ooh, they have... There's no defenses along the north side. There are glaives, though. Kane needs to be careful, but they could deal a decent amount of damage if they can get rid of these glaives. They got a micro nicely, and they are microing pretty well, losing one of their... both the bandits. Ouch! Bad time to stop microing. That could have
Acronym
been...
came in with his own glaive, which managed to just halt a metal extractor, but he stopped just in range of a Lotus. I suppose it's because both battles are going at the same time and his attention split, but both raids, not very successful there.
Yeah, and the problem is that one, though, Kane had the units to do that. They could have actually, with a bit better micro, if they had retreated just a little bit longer, they would have been able to come in and just tear everything apart. Or at the very least, force Acronym to building more glaives, fewer constructors, which would have given Kane a bit more breathing room, given them a bit more to work with. Kane going for this again, but I think it's too late. There are no defenses in the main base still, but I don't think that Akin is too concerned. Oops.
Yeah, he has radar coverage of this, so he sees these bandits coming up. He can respond to it. He's not moving into position, though. He has a single constructor, which he's keeping cloaked and keeping back so that he's hoping, you know, he doesn't want it sniped. Yeah, Kane's massing his bandits up. You want to mass your bandits up because then they become stronger in groups because they can kite and snipe out the glaives before the glaives even reach them. But he's going uphill here, so maybe Acronym's going to position to engage him first, but Kane still has the local superiority. Yeah.
Yeah, this isn't going to work. Nice try, though, by Acronym, but I think... Because the thing is, they lose radar coverage of that backside of the hill. They don't have that. They don't know exactly where the bandits are. So they can see them go on the hill, they can't see them go up the hill. Which...
Yeah, he's going to lose these two maxes, which are the harder ones to defend, but maybe he's... Yeah, he's getting some bandits, but no, it's not enough.
Not enough at all. Glaive's coming around back, no static defense. Bandits retreating wisely, though. Just get rid of these glaives.
There's too many glaives coming out of the factory. Maybe he can sort of force an engagement, force the enemy to pump glaves out one at a time and pick them off one by one.
They don't care. Look in the northeast. That's a flank. Like that. All that is a decoy.
Perfect.
They just wanted to pull Aconum's attention away from the outside of their base.
Yeah, he is losing raiders this way, but he's completely halted the expansion, and Aquanim's now back to 3 mechs.
And Kane
he's on 5.
Yeah, if Kane were to really pay attention, I'm not sure if they're aware that the +211 mechs has been taken and is totally defenseless. If they were aware of that, they'd probably go for it. There's no reason not to.
I think he's afraid of the commander there. The commander is quite threatening.
That's true.
He has the bandits coming back in again, but there's an LT set up there.
Yeah, it was 2 bandits.
But that's... Yep.
Ouch. 2 bandits for nothing. Still,
he got some information and put a little bit of threat on, but the Conjurer there is rebuilding and reclaiming.
Yeah, no real decent damage.
Yeah, Aquanim is actually accessing, and he's really stalling on energy right now. He has 1 wind generator. Oh no, he has 1 wind generator in his commander.
That's his economy gone.
And a solar, yeah, that's not enough.
Yeah, 1 solar strategy's in this map. Wind is 0.3 to 2.5 in the low ground. I think it's 0.7 to 2.5 in the high ground. Let's see. 0.6 to 2.5 in the high ground.
Any reclaim that was left behind by those bandit attacks is not being put to use at all. This is why when you attack the enemy base, you go for the energy, as I was saying. You know, in general, often you often want to go for build power as well, because build power also turns into reclaim. But he's just stalling on energy, just non-stop. And he's rushing to desperately get up solars, but... You know, this is going to really put him behind.
Yeah, whereas Kane, on the other hand, they have... How many bandits do they have? They have 12 bandits compared to about 10 glaives. So, as it is, I think it's 5-4 ratio between glaives and bandits for glaives to win. And this is less than 1-1 for the glaives.
Aquanim's trying to put the pressure on right now by positioning these glaives in a sort of contain. He's trying to raid around. And he's actually going to get something here, because this is totally undefended.
Nice.
So this is actually might be able to pull him back, but while the cat's away, Kane is sending in bandits.
Yeah, not to mention that attack. Okay, gets rid of that, which puts down to economic parity, but Kane's ahead militarily, so economic parity isn't enough.
He needs to defend this, and then he might be okay if he can defend these bandits, but that's a lot of bandits.
Ooh, and more energy going down, closing the solar, getting rid of the wind gen. Getting rid of yet another metallic stretcher. The factory is heavily threatened. The factory is being threatened at this point in the match, although unfortunately the bandits have nowhere to retreat to, getting caught out, surrounded, and killed.
Yeah, that was a really good... You could see Aquanim, the pressure he was under right there, but he managed to force Kane back right into the corner, and when you can't kite against glaives, you can't win. Glaives will catch you and kill you. And he's also taking out another metal extractor. He's going to lose glaives here, but with that, he's managed to even up the game. And Kane is back onto 4 mechs. That was really well played. That was really well done.
Yeah, that was all they needed. Because they still had the military advantage, so it's not like they lost a whole lot of military advantage in the process, especially having killed all those glaives. And, wow, Aconim still hasn't rebuilt this area yet. They're, I guess, focusing more on energy, but at this point they have enough. They have the solars up, they have a solid energy economy, they could reclaim no problem, rebuild, and now they are doing exactly that. And going for a bit of a counterattack towards the south, too. So they are going to be able to die. The glaives will have a good death running into these bandits. That's really all they can accomplish. But hey, at least they'll leave in a good-looking corpse. Or retreat. They can retreat, too. That's another option. That's probably the better option. I agree with that, Aquanim. The glaives do not want to be there. They have no chance against the bandits.
Kane is actually starting to take advantage of his reclaim economy now. He's in parity. He's still a little behind on energy, but the energy he built in desperation there is now being used to power his reclaim and his rebuilding exercise. He's making tons of cons, and if he can stall a little bit longer, he might be okay. But the problem is, as I said, in the corners, Kane has positioned his commander there, which is how you want to use your commander in the 1v1. You want to go towards a high value spot, make a little nest there, and take a bunch of mechs. And those 3 mechs, while he's also doing the thing, he knows exactly how to play this map. He has a bunch of glaives, bandits rather, around the south side. Kane has a bunch of bandits around the south side, preventing any expansion from happening to those 3 mechs, while he also takes it with his own little constructor.
Yeah, so it looks like we're going to probably see a nice flank here. The one set of bandits going towards the north, and another set, I mean, they can't really attack too heavily because of the defenses, and I don't know how aware Kane is. Okay, Kane knows this. Kane knows there's stuff here. Kane knows that Aquinim is basically over-investing in the defenses on the eastern side.
Aquinim running into it, running his glaives into an outlaw here, and he might be able to pick it off, but he's going to lose all these glaives by the look of it.
Nice tick. And at the same time, yeah, the outlaw over the south. Yeah, good tick use on those bandits. That basically saved the day for Aquinim. While also pulling away the bandits, so, or glaives rather. So
it's allowing him to, defend and stay ahead on military, but economically, with Kane taking both corners, he's rapidly falling behind.
Yeah, so Kane right now at plus 24, Aquinim at plus 31 thanks to Reclaim, and pretty much only thanks to Reclaim. Other than that, there's really not a whole lot of static No, there's basically no static economy. Looks like there's something along the lines of 12, plus 12 static economy.
So Aquinim continues to be excellent raiding, though, managing to sneak some glaives in through this ridiculous defensive line. But there's an outlaw in position there. I don't think he can take it out. He's targeting it down, but I don't think he has any chance.
No, not in time. It's close, though. No, thanks to the rogue.
Here comes the rocket, the final rocket.
With 6 HP, that outlaw manages to live. So, a complete waste. That did no damage whatsoever. Okay, got rid of one metal extractor, but that's nothing.
Can see Aquinim trying to desperately keep his keep some kind of economy advantage. He's still in the raider game, trying to pick out any metal extractor he can find. While Kane is starting to transition into his assaults, his building a shield ball, his building up roads, building about balls.
Okay. On the other hand, though, Aquinim is doing a pretty decent job raiding in the southwest side of the map. That's working.
He is playing the raider game very well. Very good at it. This is why I expect a large map like Titan Jewel or something. Looking at how well he raids.
Yeah, but I guess Kane figured that a large map like Titan Duel would be one that would very easily support something like just mass expand play that leads into good late game.
Yep. But here we have the glaives being cleaned up, but at least they took out the side, but he needs to contest this zone himself. He has three constructors up coming this direction, but his commander is contesting the enemy commander.
At this point, it looks like Kane losing a bit of ground in the northeast. Not much, but just
a bit. Yeah, he's losing ground all over, but he has this big army forcing up, which he's now going to use to put pressure on the enemy. So it's all about Kane's ability to, you know, make this pay off and really do some real damage here.
Yeah, so Kane right now, having pulled their commander back, pretty much ceding the northeast. If Aquinim were to go for the northeast, that'd be dead. But also taking the center, which if they... Are they going to cut a swath, or are they going to try to actually go around and kill everything? Because the southeast...
It looks like he's still going to continue. He's going to take the hill and then threaten the base from there.
Yeah, and
by the look of it.
Oh, and a sharpshooter coming in, but I don't think that's going to be enough. With all the
thugs and outlaws. He has a tick in position as well. The tick can only do so much against outlaws sometime, but given how tightly this is packed, he could tick it all and then kill it with glaives, and I think that's probably his strategy.
Well, we'll see. There's not many glaives, but it could work.
No, he's pulling it back.
Well, I don't know. The outlaw's going to take it out. The tick, if it moves in, is going to be destroyed by outlaws way too soon. There's no way it can get in. The outlaws are just on. Although, one of the outlaws...
It's time for taking outlaw
one goes
out,
in,
and the outlaw is ticked. Let's
not
see if he can do anything with this. He's going to try and skirmish it with these rockers.
Which might work, but not especially well. The thugs are still moving in. Looks like they're body blocking, trying to stop everything else from getting in back to the disabled forces, and... 1 second left for the disabled forces. Good body block on the sniper. The outlaw is back in play, but still Kane forced to retreat. Trying to regroup
he's
around
taken
the other side of the hill.
The rogues, and he has this big force of rockers, which means that there's only one rogue left, actually. But this means that he can just force him out and kite him, and
zero rogues.
Well
left.
Done. Good defense. But the question is, does he have any economy left after this?
Well, yeah, 13 to 29. Kane is still very much ahead. Very much in the lead, very much in a position to pull this into game 3.
And Kane is switching into bombers.
Oh, are they? Yes, they are.
No,
yeah,
no,
over in the eastern side of the map, we do see Ravens coming in. So that's probably going to be just used to maybe get rid of the sharp. Oh, no, they're going to get rid of the sharpshooter. There's not a whole lot of high priority.
He's going to go for the commander because the commander is threatening his 3-max position.
Oh,
he pulled back his own commander.
And that's going to be 2 shots. So once the second Raven's up,
damaged.
That's going to be it. And then after that, if it survives, I, as usual, recommend getting rid of the metal extractors to finish those off in the high-value mechs. I mean, this is actually very terrible anti-air defense. Aquinim is not expecting this. There's 3 defenders, which will help a bit. Well, 2 defenders in effect, because one of them is losing all of its missiles, getting rid of the solar collector. So in effect, there's two defenders, and that's not going to be enough. That'll damage one of the Ravens, but don't kill it before it's too late.
In the south, Akron's making stuff happen with his own constructors, constructor versus constructor war, using these little cloak constructors to build lotuses. So that area still remains contested, but he needs to claim it if he wants to be on parity with Kane.
Okay, now Kane moving in, being absolutely sure with a couple extra bombers just for good measure. While Akron moves out, Kane should be able to take out the commander. That commander is going to go down. Akron loses their commander, but at the same time, they do have a lot of Rockos coming in. And those aren't high-priority targets. We don't have any Phoenixes to help deal with those. Some are on the way, though. Kane is building Phoenixes at this point, which is, of course, the right move. Mm. Just getting rid of that sharpshooter. No felons yet, though. I'm not sure if Kane is waiting for the sharpshooter or they're just not bothering with felon this particular game.
It can be difficult to go felon. If the enemy's already gone sharpshooters, it can be difficult to transition to felons without also transitioning into Aspices, which requires a lot of energy, which he probably doesn't have because he really has more. He's still accessing.
No, they're on par for metal and energy. They don't have any real energy, energy excess or energy advantage compared to metal. They do, however, have an overall economic advantage, so at least don't have to worry about that. And nice spread by Aquanum. Not sure if they expect. I guess they must have seen that Phoenix coming. Only lost about half of the only lost a couple Rockos in the process. The sharpshooter was spotted out and has been destroyed. Now, are we going to see felons coming in, or are we still going to be worried about new sharpshooters coming in? Because Aquanum has no plans to go for that at this point, or at least they aren't tipping their hand on them.
He's going back to Raiders. I think he knows at this point he's going to be fairly contained, and he just needs Raiders to sort of force out these Rockos.
Actually,
there's probably too many Rockos at this point to act for Raiders to be really effective. I would use Roaches in this circumstance. But a felon would also actually kill the Rockos because it outranges them.
Oh, I see. Yeah, right. Yeah, Kane's going for the Raiders while Aquanum goes for Gremlins to try to get rid of the Ravens, which isn't really enough. Especially given that on the ground is the main threat. Like, the Ravens just sort of hanging out.
The Rockos are an excellent response because the shields just soak up the
Rocko
fire.
Oh, totally.
They can't miss them. But it's just not enough. Despite excellent raiding, he's been too behind on economy. You know, he tried to catch up, and he did a really good defense, but Kane having his commander in position just to take those corner mexes was really good, and he held them for too long, and Kane's pulled too far ahead.
I think we're moving on to game three pretty soon, just as a result of this particular fight. Although this actually, maybe not. This fight's actually the one that could pull us into finishing the round. Really depends on how Aquanum handles this, but I don't know. Aquanum would basically... No, never mind. Aquanum needs to basically win without losing anything. They're doing a decent job of doing that, but the Gremlins were unfortunately a bad choice, and I think that's going to cost them the game. Had they gone for Warriors instead, that probably would have been a completely different story. But they did not read it right. They had a really bad read there. They expected Kane to go for air just over and over, take out the Metal Extractors, take out the Forces directly. But that's not what happened. Kane had long since been going for the raiding game, and as a result, put Aquanum in a position where they did not have the proper counters to deal with the Raiders, which means they are basically going to be torn to shreds. Like losing Gremlin after Gremlin.
Aquanum managed to finally take out the corners. He has LLT sitting on the lower one, and on the top one, he actually almost has one of the mexes himself.
Yeah, but that's GG. It's game. But yeah, they took the corners, which was... Well, it took the southwest. The northeast was... They took one of the metal extractors, but didn't really contest it as well as they could have before the commander got killed.
Yeah, beginning to contest it, though. Like, one glaive would have sort of... One or two glaives would have sort of
Turned
that up. But by the time he'd finally done that, he just had... He was just too far... Too far gone. And the air switch sort of... And the comm snipes finished him off.
Yep, so we are going to be moving on to game three, which is going to be on Kane's chosen map. Aquanum's chosen map. Well, Aquanum's suggestion of map into Kane's choice, because that's the way it works now. And also point out in the brackets that we have, as we move into game three, we do have Failthos will be up against Drone from the looks of it. I mean, that's kind of obvious, but okay, why is it not updated? Anyway, yeah, Failthos is up against Drone in the winter semis, while the... What else is it? Yeah, so winner semis, Failthos is up against Drone. Steel Blue will be up against the winner of this match. Sorry, or the next match, because Aquanum and Kane is actually kind of holding us up. rather surprisingly, in fact.
They're both really good players, though. You really see how you know, the decisions they're making are just, like, just excellent. I mean, even when they're behind, the way they raid, the way they manage to slip units through, you know, sometimes their micro is a little bit lacking, and they'll lose a force that they didn't really need to. But you saw that stellar defense where he held his glaives back for as long as possible until the bandits were trapped in the corner, and then he pushed in on them where they couldn't retreat and managed to kill them down. It's so hard fighting from when you're down against bandits, because the bandits can kite you and kite you and kite you. Especially, indefinitely.
Yeah, without
and you
warriors.
You just keep losing forces.
Without
you
warriors.
You know, the whole thing was anything. Really stellar play from both players.
Yeah, so 1 second, need water. So keep talking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and now we see Titan Jewel. Here we go. I said it was going to happen. Yeah, Titan Jewel. We can expect a lot more of that. Sort of really raider focused play. A lot of really good, interesting micro. A lot of expansion and back and forth play from both these players, who are both very good at it. I expect probably a vehicle mirror here. Maybe vehicle hovercraft.
Well,
but
yeah, hovercrafts have, well, they're so out of popularity, I don't expect to see any. They have not been in the meta.
What happened? Because they were the meta, and then we didn't see anything, and now they're not.
I honestly don't know, actually. That's been confusing me, too, especially on water maps. I casted a game on Kull, which was Amphib Mirror. That's the hovercraft dream map. And they were playing Amphib Mirror.
Amphibs are very strong on water. It's a weird different thing, but
that's,
I mean,
true.
They were the dominant pick. I think it's people are a little more used to. I mean, scrubbers are sort of a little bit difficult to use, and if you whittle them down, you don't get anywhere. But, I mean, you have to get the critical mass with the scrubbers, and if you can achieve that, then you're doing really well. But
yeah,
scorches are easier to use because you just ram something and they always do damage.
Well, I think what it is that hovercraft doesn't have a whole lot of options. Like, they have daggers at the start. And then you have halberds if they go for defense, and you have maces that they have a few powerful units, but maces are very slow. So you end up with a situation where they basically don't have a lot of answers. And yeah, light vehicle mirror, because light vehicle has answers. Light vehicle has tons of answers, while hovercraft has, like I said, not much. You're basically having to be on the offensive. If you're not the one dictating the pace of the game as hovercraft, it seems like they just don't really do much.
Yeah, I definitely think you can also, maybe not so much on a map this large, but you can definitely have big scalpel balls, which are incredibly threatening. But you are sort of, you have a few really decent mainline units, but it's not so much, and some of them are a little bit specialized, and so there's certain options and flexibilities you don't have as a hovercraft player.
I think the problem...
I think interesting to see the difference in the play here, where you have... this tricky micro bandit, this micro dart play, but doesn't pay off, gets caught by a scorcher.
No. But yeah, the thing with hovercraft is that it's just, you have scalpel balls, sure, but you need to be able to build up to them. Or daggers, you need to be able to build up to them. Everything that hovercraft does, except halberds, they need to build up to it. And I guess
yeah,
maces,
they really,
but it's
you yeah,
the, you,
you
have
to
dictate
to
the pace
alive.
Of
you need
the game.
A ball of them.
You can't be the one responding. If you're the one that's responding, if you're the one that's being told what to do, where you're trying to set up your own units in order to deal with your opponent, you've already lost with hover. Or it seems like that's the case if you think about their options. Like, the only option I think that would deal with that once it gets to that point would possibly be mace, but even then, numbers are important.
Yeah, you can't afford to lose any of your scrubbers. You need to get them all alive and snipe things out one at a time with your scrubbers until you can transition into one of the bigger units. But in this match we see more Scorcher versus Scorcher, so much more sort of traditional style. And two Scorchers coming in, which might threaten, but
they're getting body
blocked. Just a morphed commander and just going to lose one for nothing.
This map, I'm just going to go over the map, but this map, for those not familiar, is, like, as you can see, corner to corner, everything's +2. With the cluster in the main base, and then everything really separated from that. So you get a lot of risky play just to get basic economic expansion after the first 5 metal extractors, which means there's a nice set of harassment. But also, what tends to happen on this map, because of the way the choke points are laid out, when you're playing vehicles on vehicles, you typically see players, they'll run lines of scorchers to block their opponents. Like, they basically just, they're body blocking. That's the only way I can describe it. They're running interference on their enemies' scorchers or enemies' units coming in, just to prevent them from coming in and basically put enough pressure where their opponent goes, oh crap, if I move in here, I'm going to lose all of my units.
Mm.
And Akram did not respect that right there, losing a bunch of their Scorchers as a result. And Kane in a very nice position to move forward.
Drone notices, mentions Kane has not built a single turret. He's defending entirely with Raiders and three radar
And they're doing a great job. Towers, they're, yeah. Like I said, they're just, they know how to block it. They, if they know what's going on, and they totally do, they can block everything Aquanum sets in. Or sends
this
in.
This is how you play if you want to be, you know, like extreme Gosu maximum, you know, Raider style, is you just build nothing but Raiders and Raiders. Raiders and radars.
Yeah.
And,
where is Andy anyway?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's good to see this kind of play, but we'll see whether it pays off, because Kane's actually down on military advantage right now.
They are, but they have the defender's advantage, they have the retreat advantage there. Oh, they're losing another Scorcher, though. I think that second Scorcher is really going to make a difference. If Aquanum capitalizes on it, which I don't know if they're going to. They are going down south, though. Kane is not in position. Aquanum able to successfully mix up Kane's defense if they attack, which they aren't. So they're not They're not taking advantage of the situation that they've put themselves in.
This is a Morph Commander, and it has enough time to get up a beam laser, so he's not going to have any trouble here.
No.
He might lose the Metal Extractor, but he's going to take out the Scorchers, which is really what he wants to do.
Yeah, and that is unfortunate, because that...
doesn't even take out the LT.
But that's a waste, because like I said, Kane didn't have enough Scorchers to deal with this. They actually were in a position where Aquanum could have moved in and destroyed pretty much everything because of the lack of Scorchers defending, and the Scorchers being out of position. And that they didn't get punished for.
It's a risky thing to do, though, because if you run into a single LT or a single defender, or you run into, because he has this intel, you know he has radar
on
you. He can position himself so that the moment you enter his LT range, he jumps on you with Scorchers and you lose all your units. So yeah, it's a very difficult call to make. He made the call to sort of do the dip and dive where he comes in one direction, takes out a Scorcher, pulls around, comes in the other direction. It was just unfortunate that he left a Constructor, which was almost completely open, and ran into a Commander instead. So Kane's almost zero defense strategy is really paying off here.
Well, yeah, it's just not being punished. There hasn't been enough scouting from Aquanum to actually call Kane's bluff.
Mm.
And that's huge. Like, that is such a big deal. This is why I always say people just need to scout more on this. If there's anything that I think that we all, as a community of players, forget to do, all of us, everyone, I can't think of anyone who really does this on a regular basis, myself included, is scout more. Like, yeah, you're going to lose units, just sack units for intelligence. Understanding the value of intelligence seems to be something that I can't think of anyone who really actually does that in practice. It's very, very scary, because you're throwing units away, you're throwing reclaim at your opponent, and it's really hard to figure out the value of intelligence compared to the value of the reclaim you're donating in the process.
Yeah. And here we have Kane going in.
Nice.
He split his forces around that sinkhole, and yeah, he's losing Scorchers for no reason. So this has swung an advantage seriously into Aquanum's favor that he can put on the pressure now.
And not
because their economies are mostly in parity.
Oh, not just that though. I don't know if you noticed the way Aquanum had bunched up their Scorchers in order to make sure that the heat rays only hit the outside Scorchers, and that was it, giving Aquanum a lot of essentially completely protected, fully defended Scorchers in the center of that formation. I have never seen someone do that before, because normally you wouldn't think to do that, but against Scorchers, that's like the one case where boxing up like that's actually really handy.
Yeah,
but Scorchers are the one exception.
It's swung back in parity though, because he sent his phone forces in piecemeal, so they just have a fairly even Scorcher numbers.
So at this point, Aquanum's taking the northeast, Kane's taking the southwest.
He's going up north now and taking out this expanding structure, hitting it exactly the same at the time he chooses to build an LT, while his own forces are trying to come and intercept these reinforcements.
That is some very nice timing from Kane. They are in Aquanum's head at this point. Like, everything they're doing is just taking advantage of Aquanum. Like, both this game and last game, they were doing so many things, taking advantage of Aquanum's reactions, rather than just going for what they know. They go for what they're fairly certain Aquanum is going to do afterwards. They're just making good reads. Like, every
Kane
single play.
He's not rated very much, though. The pressure has been from Aquanum, so he hasn't actually done much economic damage. So this means that he's still very much ahead, though. And it's his commander in the corner, which is setting up his little nest and taking up the expansion, the equivalent expansion that he just took out from Aquanum. So that's going to be enough that he's now really pulling ahead on economy.
Well, given that Kane had no towers, I'm not surprised. The thing is, you can't really be offensive if you're going this hyper expansion. No, well, I guess you can if you want to make your opponent confused, but you can't if you want to be. If you're assuming your opponent's going to call your bluff, then you don't want them to actually go, "Oh, hey, wait a sec, they're being defensive. They probably don't have any defenses. They probably only
have." Kane's pulled around the side here. He's pulled these around the side to try and raid where the enemy isn't, but this left Aquanim open to really take advantage of this with his mobile Scorcher Force, pull in here and take out this side expansion and possibly the commander, but the commander's getting reinforcements, so the commander's safe. But he's going to lose, if Aquanim knows what he's doing, he's going to pull back.
Does know what
he might run into these levelers.
Look at the look at the center.
The interception with the levelers. Oh no, he's pulled back. He's avoided the levelers and he's going around the side, back into the territory that. Oh no!
And Kane's commander has been
away.
Sniped. And being great. And also, there's another force over in the center. I was pointing out before. So we have basically a three-pronged flank here. Although one of the prongs is too far behind for it to be relevant. But still, at least two of the prongs coming in here, dealing a lot of damage, getting behind the lack of defenses, and the Ravager's not doing enough, getting dodged way too easily. Aquanim wisely not dealing with them directly. They're just going around them, just pulling everything along, like stringing all this stuff along while taking over the north side as well.
Like, meanwhile, I'm taking out these forces. That was such a swing. That was amazing. That was so well done.
That was the play. That was the play of the game right there. That
was
turn it around.
The way Kane was really good. He sent the levelers in to intercept. You're like, oh no, he's going to lose all those forces. But he just swung them around the south, went in. It's like, okay, he's going to go suicide attack, take out as much economy as he can. And while all those Scorchers rush in to try and chase the other ones, the commander just gets torn apart. So now Kane has this big assault force of Ravagers, which is
this
what
is
he's switched into.
This
he
is the last
ditch.
This is the last
ditch. He needs to make something happen. He needs to kill that commander. Which he looks like he's in position
to do. Commander's
going to
die.
Down.
It's just that, they need to not just kill the commander, they need to rip apart about half of Aquanim's economy.
He's in a position to.
They are, true.
This is the whole economic advantage right here has been transformed into military advantage, and he needs to make something happen
this. Needs to stabilize.
Aquanim needs to defend this if he wants to. This looks like it might even stabilize.
But yeah,
the,
like Kane's, that was the reason of Kane's play, is that as soon as Kane screws up a read on Aquanim, Aquanim's going to be able to pull out either positionally or in terms of unit types exactly what they need to do, and they did exactly that.
He's pulling back. There's so many Ravagers here. This is going to be difficult for him because it's very hard to defend against Ravagers because there's no real clear counter in these larger numbers. In low numbers, Scorchers are good, but and you can do things with Dominatrices, but this is really difficult against this size of a force.
Yeah, so Kane, at least...
Yeah, his own Ravagers
are
torn apart.
At least they have the economy. They don't have to worry about making good guesses. They just have to have the units they need.
There's still a Scorcher in the base running around taking out these repairing. And this is the danger when you do this expansionistic style where you don't put defenses in your base. It means that if your front line is ever breached, a single Scorcher is going around and taking out all his re-expansion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is really difficult.
And only Raptors coming in to try to reinforce the front. Aquanim is still very, very comfortable. I don't see Kane pulling out of this without destroying everything. Like, these half-dozen Raptors have to win.
This one hero Scorcher. Wow, his Scorcher, Aquanim's Scorcher play has been so good.
It doesn't even get the experience for it, too.
One hero Scorcher.
It doesn't even have... I'm just getting distracted.
It's got a little veterancy thing. It's made cost, it's done its work.
I didn't see the veterancy. Anyway, doesn't really matter. The point is that Kane is so open, so weak, that these half-dozen Raptors have to be winning the game. Like, they have to win the game, or Kane is into losers.
Yeah, he pulled them back.
Kane's
he did a lot of damage.
Yeah, there he is.
But Kane didn't take out enough Solas. The Solas are actually overdriving this point, despite the reclaim, which means that he has so much. He has plus 45 energy. He can turn all his reclaim instantly back into an army and swing this back around, whereas Kane is on, plus 22 energy. And it's just not enough. He has some reclaim in his base, but it's not enough.
They barely have enough to build. Like, they barely have enough to build without accessing metal.
Yeah, that was a brilliant opening gambit from Kane, really well played, but that's the thing when you play that way, one mess up, one miss micro, the enemy gets in your base, you lose your commander, everything gets, destroyed, and all your economic advantage that you managed to accumulate, even though you have the military advantage, if you can't swing that advantage back, and now they're on parity and Ravagers.
Yeah, and there's nothing else really being pulled in, there's no other units, no levelers being pulled in to help splash it out, it's just... It's just
Raptors. That's one thing you can do in the really large groups. You can mix in levelers,
Yeah, I've noticed that
it's not a hard counter.
It isn't, but I find it tends to be used with pretty decent success. It's just that neither player's really going for it. And Kane, well, they do have actually a slight numerical advantage here, and they are in a nice position. They got a nice surround on those Raptors, taking out a few for free, unfortunately taking a few of their own for free as well. Not content with only killing Aquanim's Raptors, their bloodlust must be sated with their own kind.
He's holding on, but he's really, he's not even expanding his energy economy.
No.
He's on, you know, just like 9 solar panels. That's all he's got against like 22.
And the reclaim isn't helping either.
That's the real difference. Yeah, I mean, because you can have reclaim, you can expand. Once you get inserted into the middle of the game, energy becomes a much more important resource because there's so much reclaim and there's lots of territory to take.
Just to put the nail in the coffin, the Thunderbird being built up for Aquanim. If it stuns out these Raptors, Kane's going to throw it in. We're going to see Kane in losers. Like, I don't see Kane getting out of this.
Excellent play from both players. Just beautiful, I think. That was just exquisite, what we saw from those Scorches. The response from both players there was really, really good, but just one slip up. And this is the thing when you play this very dangerous style where you don't have any defenses and you get to the sort of halfway of the map and you start building your defense line, but once that gets breached, and it's quite easy to breach with Scorchers and very easy to breach with Ravagers. Once something gets behind that line, there's nothing there to defend it.
Yeah, or if the line just isn't thick enough. Like in that particular case, the line actually had nothing around that particular corner that the Scorchers went around.
Yeah, it's the gambit that what I was talking about earlier with the glaives, that you don't want to send the glaives into the base. He deliberately saw that, you know, I'm going to lose these units because I'm being chased. I'm going to send them straight for the economy and get to as much damage as I can. That's
yeah,
the time
they die.
You want to dive for the base and do as much damage to the economy as you can. But it was also perfect with the distraction at the same time from the other direction with
and
the comm snipe.
Yeah,
when his comm was perfectly defended by tons of Scorchers, but he pulled those Scorchers back to chase into his own base.
Yeah.
He should have left them there. And because you're not going to chase them, you're never going to catch the Scorchers.
No, it's the same speed as your Scorchers, it's the same unit type.
Yep.
But it's hard to realize.
And then it does nothing, it stuns out 3 Scorchers, so.
Oh, ouch.
It's still Ravage Rewards for a while yet, but.
It is, although there should be another Thunderbird on the way. Yeah, there is, it's just about done. 14 seconds left.
Yeah, this is something your game where you were chasing, you had the Glaive Pack come through and wipe out sort of everything, and you were sort of chasing them back. If you remember that game, I think some of our viewers might. That you can't intercept something with it, something that's the same speed or slower if it's moving into a base. You need some units that
are
coming out of your factory to intercept it. To
yeah,
push it back
that's
as it's coming in.
But
yeah.
That's the thing. That's also why I always recommend. Sorry, that's always why I always recommend cutting. As I mean, you mentioned before in the Cooper Hill game, but yeah, just cutting in between your opponent's base and some other and their army, so that they're forced to retreat because at some point you're going to slow down as you're weaving around and killing things. But it's that or they lose everything. So they have to pull back, but they also can't pull back fast enough because their units are just the same speed or slower.
Yep. Kane's transitioned into Scorchers to try and, you know, they can counter Ravages in small numbers, but I think there's too many here, and he's getting hit by Thunderbirds, and he's having real struggle. The economic advantage that Aquanim's pulled ahead is really coming out. Kane's putting up a really valiant defense here. We see some excellent micro, some excellent...
Oh, yeah, actually, well... Small numbers are a local question, as we can see here in the north, with the Raptor line being split apart. And the Thunderbird not doing
on.
Much. Well, relying on, but
it's
not
doing
quite
enough,
paying
though.
Attention
he,
to.
He's putting up a really strong effort here, but there's only so much you can do. He's still on 9 solar panels. He still hasn't expanded that. He's just trying to survive.
And there's
2
Thunderbirds,
on
both of which are completely loaded. Like, whenever Aquanim wants, they can stun out everything. And looks like now is what? No, they don't even need to at this point. Raptors moving in for the kill. Stunning out the
back.
What?
That's nice. That's not bad because he stunned out the build power.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, it's actually that one as well did so much damage, taking out those extra caretakers and that sort of stuff. Yeah, it did so much extra damage.
And that's game.
That's game.
For interrupting, but yeah, that was totally game.
Yeah. No,
wow.
I got very hyped about that. I've been going on and on because that game was just insane. That was excellent.
That was probably one of the best games
played.
Of the tournament. I don't know if there'll be another game of that quality in this tournament. We'll see.
I think we'll definitely see some interesting stuff. I think with this, you saw in the earlier games just how good their Raider micro was, their expansion from both players here is. So I was excited to see them on a map like Titan Duel where they can really show that off. And I think you saw it We can definitely expect to see some players pull out some shenanigans as well, some, you know, interesting tech choices and things like that. And we're also going to see the air game play out where the people are going to go rapiers or bombers. We've seen a lot of planes in this match, which is very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't choose to go for rapiers. They went for stilettos, which is very reasonable against Ravagers.
Yeah.